Guys, I found a cordyceps fungus growing out of the noggin of an ant here. This is one of the most exciting things I've found here. I'm in the Osa Peninsula in Costa Rica right now, and there are some of these things up in temperate areas, but the humid tropics is where they really thrive. I've never found one before, though. If you haven't heard of these things before, they are absolutely bananas in the idiomatic sense, because I think I have these species on this one. I think it's Ophiocordyceps unilateralis, the zombie ant fungus. Could be corrected, but these are some of the most bizarre parasitic organisms that I know of. It's a fungus, but its whole life cycle revolves around ants, especially this particular type of ant. I believe this is a carpenter ant. As an ant, you do not want to get infected with this. Like, at least seeing from a human point of view, it would not be a pleasant way to die. Typically, the ants that get infected with this, they live in the canopy, and for the most part, they stay in the canopy. But if you're unfortunate enough to have to end up on the ground, whether you fall out of the canopy or you have to go there to get to another tree, beware. Because randomly on the floor, you might come across a patch of this thing's spores, and then you're probably toast. If you get in contact with them, they'll kind of cling onto your body, start to release enzymes that break down the proteins in your cuticle, the outer layer in your body, and just start gobbling up the sugars and amino acids that come out from that, kind of eating through, maybe releasing some antibacterial compounds to make sure other things don't infect you at the same time. Once it breaks its way in, it kind of changes form to become more like a yeast and then starts multiplying within your blood. Like, insects don't have true blood, but it's called hemocell. So by this point in your infection, you've probably returned to your home in the canopy, which isn't a good place for the fungus to survive. It's less humid, more hot and dry, more sunny than is good for a lot of fungi to grow. So what's a fungus to do? Well, within a couple days, you're pretty well infected. So now the fungus starts to release toxins and take over your nervous system. With those toxins, you begin to convulse a little bit and you fall from the canopy. You might land on a lower branch, lower down, but or you might land on the ground. Either way, you kind of end up wandering aimlessly for a while. And eventually you end up climbing a little ways back up a tree. Not to your home, but usually only to within a couple meters of the ground. This one was like a meter and a half off the ground. Ah, says the fungus, that's a better place. More humid, more cool. And then somehow the fungus sends a signal to you that you need to go to the underside of a leaf where you're more shielded from the elements and just find the center stem and clamp down like you've never clamped before and just hang on like there's no tomorrow. And soon enough, there isn't. This stage is called the death grip, understandably so. Once here, the fungus starts to break down your muscles and your tissues, so even if you want to, you can't let go. You can't release that grip because you don't have the muscles to do so anymore. And if that wasn't enough, these fungal structures, it grows out more just attaching the rest of your body to the leaf. So even if you could release your jaw, you're still not going anywhere. And the fungus just keeps going, eating out your insides and replacing them with its own tissues. Soon enough, the lights go off for you, and you're just an empty shell of an exoskeleton protecting your parasite. The fungus is now ready. I guess, strictly speaking, it's not the noggin it comes out of, like I said earlier, but out of the back of the pronotum, kind of the neck area, sticks out a stalk, releases its spores, and because you're on the underside of a leaf, releases them downward to create a minefield on the ground for any other ants unfortunate enough to walk that way. Now, we can't really know what this is all like from an ant's point of view, how it thinks and feels, but to anthropomorphize it for a moment, to just pretend it sees life like a human sees it. What a way to go. To slowly just start feeling weird and start spasming unpredictably and losing direction, wandering aimlessly, and just finding yourself clamping down on a leaf, unable to let go, and just watching over the period of a few days as the world moves beneath you and you slowly fade away. Ugh. It's interactions like these that sometimes just jar you into realizing how complex interspecies interactions can be. Like, that is so bizarrely specific of a life cycle, and such a weird way of controlling its host. If I'd never heard of this, I never would have dreamt something like that up. Now, I should probably clarify, just before I frighten anyone, there's no known way that any of these can infect humans. So we're safe there, but I mean, there's some fascinating interactions, to be fair, between pathogens and human brains, but those are stories for another day and probably for someone with a lot more expertise in the field. But fascinating stuff, parasites. I was just browsing a cecropia tree and there was this guy under a leaf. Bit of an odd place for it. Like, cecropia trees have a relationship with certain species of ants, symbiotic ones, but I think this is the wrong species of ant. Like, maybe it came from a canopy a little ways off. I'm not sure. And walked a distance. In any case, though, that's all I have for this week. As always, thank you for liking, commenting, and subscribing. And for more beautiful and sometimes mind-boggling oddities from the plant and fungus worlds, join me next time on Ambling with Sam.